All right, this class is being recorded. Today is Wednesday, February 1st, 2023. This is the 2 p.m. section 301. Today we're going to really primarily focus on two things. One, the Bloomberg Trading Challenge. And two, we are going to focus on lecture note two on EIC, which will also be part of your homework too, which is due on Monday. Right? So let's start out with the Bloomberg Trading Challenge. So that starts today. It's your first team project. So I put out an announcement yesterday. Here is the link. To a Google form to submit your team captain. So what's going to happen is we're going to start a challenge where there are six teams in each section. You're going to compete against the other teams in your section. Today you're going to start with $1 million worth of cash. Starting today, you're going to trade equities for the next 6 weeks, either buying stocks or selling short stocks. We're going to keep track of your performance. At the end of the 6 weeks, we're going to then take a score. The team with the highest portfolio value gets the highest grade. The team with the lowest portfolio gets the lowest grade. Each of your teams is going to be registered to the name of the team captain's Bloomberg account. So they will be the only one who have access to the trading challenge, and they will act on behalf of your team. Now, very important, just because they're acting on behalf of your team doesn't mean they're doing all the work for your team. But the whole team should participate in figuring out who you should be buying and selling. They're just the ones that are actually accessing the software to do it, okay? But I would also say that make sure that this is a responsible person, because the only way to participate in the trading challenge is through their account, okay? So if they never log in, they don't do anything, it's gonna be really bad for your team, okay? But nonetheless, this starts today, so identify who that person is, right? Because by Monday, you're starting out with $1 million worth of cash. By Monday, you cannot have more than $300,000 of cash from Monday to any point going forward the rest of the semester. If at any time your team rises to more than $300,000 in cash or higher, your team will be disqualified. You'll all get zeros for the assignment, and none of you will be able to opt out of the final exam, and a bunch of people are going to be pissed off at their team captains. Okay? So very important that by Monday, you're out of cash, because the whole point is this is an equity trading challenge. You got to be in stocks. You can't be in cash. I don't care if the market goes down 20% this week. You're going to keep trading, okay, regardless of what the market is happening. Start selling short, right? But nonetheless, it starts today. Once you've identified who your captain is, I will register them for the trading challenge. There are two ways to access the trading challenge in Bloomberg. You either type in idea, or you type in TMSG. They both get you to the same place. Now, unfortunately, if I don't register you, it's gonna be blank for you and you won't be able to do anything. Now, we have a privilege where Bloomberg set up what we are able to do for themselves so that they can run competitions across universities. We are unique in that they're giving us, because we have such a big license, to be able to create our own trading challenges within this class. And specifically, there are four, one for each one of the sections, okay? So no other school could do this. We're the only ones that they're allowing to do this. So it's actually very nice of them. So the point is, as the administrator, I've been doing this for a few years, so I actually can see a lot of different competitions. You will only see one, the class that you're registered for. But, and I know it's annoying, whoever's logged in, every time you come to the screen, you have to select your one trading challenge from the drop-down menu, okay? Even though there will only be one. It doesn't load by default, right? Now, here is an example of one of the competitions from last semester. It's over, ended in December. They haven't traded since then. So there were six teams. They competed against each other. And over here, this is a column called Portfolio Value. If you click on Portfolio Value, it'll rank them. This team, if we were running it again right now, would be in first place. This team would be in last place. So it doesn't matter where you are at any point in time until the end. So when this ends, I'll rank you, and the team that's in first place gets 5 points. Then 4, 4, 3, 2, 1 will be the point distribution. Okay? And again, can't have more than $300,000 available cash at any point in time. Right? Now, once you're the team captain, these will be the captains. Let's say I'm the team that won. You must make at least 10 longs, is what they're called, each half of the semester. So that means you have to invest in at least 10 companies. All right? If you don't invest in 10 companies, you're going to be disqualified. It doesn't matter how many shorts you do. You have to do a minimum of 10 longs. Now, you can see the team that won this class last semester made 26 investments. They had the most. It's not always correlated. So if I click on this, and I'm the captain, I can see everybody I bought. Okay, so this team bought companies from NVIDIA to Alibaba to Kroger to Target to Apple, Humana, etc. Okay, so these are all the companies they bought. And this is kind of the performance of each individual stock. The total portfolio is across the top. Notice it's updating in real time because the market's open. Right? Also, and just an important point, if you need to sell a stock that you bought, there's a circle red X. That's how you sell a stock. It's called closing the idea in Bloomberg parlance. Okay? So this is where you will buy. This is where you will sell. Make sense? All right. So what I'm going to do is earlier today, I had created a competition for the 101 section. And I added the teams. There's four of the six teams that I added earlier today. They don't show up until they actually start buying or selling stock. So there's two parts. I have to add you, and then you have to actually buy something in order for you to show up in this list. Okay, so once you do, you and your peers will start to be on this list. Now, I bought one stock earlier today. As an example, I bought Costco, and you can see that in the couple hours since I bought it, I've made $867 on my investment. So again, it's tracking my investment from the earlier section, the 11 a.m. section today in real time. Okay. Now, what I'm going to do right now, I'm going to take this network is what it's called, and I'm going to clone it, starting everybody with $1 million. And this is going to be UMD, and I believe this is section 301. Okay, and I'm going to get rid of their captains. And this is your competition is now ready to go. So all I need is your team numbers. Once you put them in that Google form, I'll start adding you to the list later today. Okay? Now, if you want to know the rules for the competition, buying and selling stocks, you can also go up here to settings and click on rules. And this will give you a summary of the rules. If you click on the rules summary. Okay. So a few important rules that you need to be aware of. First, when you buy and sell stocks, you're making market orders. So I'm limiting the competition to just equities. Like in Bloomberg, you can trade anything, but I'm limiting it to just equities. Secondly, I'm limiting it to market orders. So no limit orders. So that means if you want to buy something, you have to physically go in and buy it. If you want to sell something, you have to physically go in and sell it. You can't say sell Costco if it goes below 390. Like you could in the real world, in the competition you cannot. That's why your team captain is very important. So if you put a bunch of money into Intel, and last week after that earnings call, their stock starts plummeting, if your team captain doesn't go in and do anything, your team's going to continue to lose money. Okay? So you want to sell something, you got to go in and actually buy or sell it in the market order. Right? Now, when it does the buy or sell at the market order, it's also going to fill it through a real-world system. So it's going to look at the bids and asks when it actually fills the order. So even though you might say a market price, if you do a big block of stock, it might have to go to a bigger lot in order to fulfill that price. So it's going to try and fulfill it based on real-world lots. That also means you can invest in any company anywhere in the world, as long as it's publicly traded. But here's the limitation. You invest in some random small traded stock in some country that's not the US. If you put in a big order, there may not be enough shares of stock available to complete that order. And that's the point. Like you put in a $200,000 order for some small tiny stock in Thailand. Like if there's not a float for that stock, it won't complete the order. Same thing. If you sell a stock and there's no buyers for that stock, it won't complete the order. So if you're trading in like Apple or Pfizer or Ford or somewhere like that, you're not going to have this issue, right? But I'm just alerting you that it's using the real world system the trade, even though it's fake money, right? Now, the other thing that's important is that I used to make teams write up the rationale for every trade they made at the end of the semester. They hated writing the papers. I didn't really like grading the papers, right? So what we did now is that every time you buy or sell a stock, you write your rationale at the time of buying or selling the stock. The rationale must be 50 characters. So to put that into perspective, that's one third of a tweet, right? So it's like a sentence. It doesn't have to be too long, but why'd you buy or sell the stock? You got to put it in there, right? Next, you can't put less than $10,000 into any one stock. You got $1 million to allocate. You're not going to buy $100 at Costco, right? So minimum $10,000, maximum 20% of your cash. So if I have $1 million, I can't put more than $200,000 in Costco, right? Now, if Costco goes up and I own more than $200,000, I don't have to sell it, but I won't be able to buy any more. Okay. The other thing is that from a commission standpoint, you're going to get institutional commission, which is a penny a share. So if I buy 1,000 shares of Costco, $10 commission, right? So commissions are not going to matter too much, but nonetheless, we did put that in here. And when The Wolf of Wall Street came out a few years ago, we started doing this competition. Everybody got excited about the pink sheets and penny stocks. So I put in a minimum market cap of $500 million. So if the company doesn't have a market cap, $500 million, currency adjusted, it won't let you buy it. Okay? And people got excited about penny stocks, so which is not the point of the competition. So I also put in a minimum price of $3. So if the stock is trading for less than $3, it won't let you buy it. Now, if you buy a stock and it goes below $3, you can sell it, but then you won't be able to buy it back. Okay? So minimum market cap of $500 million, minimum share price of $3. Okay? And then the final thing is I've eliminated day trading. Okay? So any stock you buy today, you can't sell until the next business day, tomorrow. If you short a stock today, you can either go long or you can short, then you can cover it tomorrow. Okay, so there's no same day trading. There's also no after market trading. Okay, so if you buy something at 5 p.m. in the U.S. and the market's closed, it won't execute until the next business day. Okay, if you try and buy a stock that's on like the Hong Kong or Singapore exchange, well, it's like 12 o'clock at night there. So the market's not open over there. So you'd have to wait until the market is open local time in the exchange for your trade to complete. Okay, just alerting you about that. So again, same thing. You buy something on the weekend, it's not going to trade until Monday, assuming Monday's not a holiday. Okay, so you're using the real system. You're just trading with fake money. Yes, sir?
If I were to do one of these things, does the system allow me to do it?
So if you try and trade, the system will warn you if you trip any flag. Okay, so that's the point. Now, how do you trade? So assuming all these rules, you're on the screen, you're your team captain, you come here, and you're in your drop down, you're going to select 301, and then you're going to go compose, which is basically buy a stock. It's called compose. If you've already been looking at a stock, whatever stock was last on Bloomberg before you went to the screen will automatically be loaded. I was on Costco, so it automatically loaded Costco. If I wanted to buy somebody else, I just switched my ticker to somebody else. Okay? So let's say I want to buy Square. Okay, so I buy Square, called Block Inc. now is what they're called. All right? It's going to give me their current price, $80.55. Now, $80.63. I can choose to either go long, which means buy the stock, or short it. Right? And then finally, down here, you won't have this because I've done a lot of competitions in a lot of sections, but it'll automatically have shown your section as 301 spring 23. 1H means first half because we're going to have a second half sprint. It's grayed out this drop down, which is going to force you to do a market order at the next tick as opposed to a limit order, right? And then you put in the dollar amount that you want to buy, and then Bloomberg will figure out the shares, right? So what I'm going to do for Square is I'm going to buy 250, and you can use K if you want to be lazy, $1,000 of Square, okay? And then up here, send is where you submit your order. And then Bloomberg is going to alert me that I violated two rules, right? Rule number one, I tried to buy more than $200,000. Not allowed. Rule number two is I didn't put my write-up on why I wanted to buy Square. Okay, so cancel. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to adjust this to $200,000. And then down here is where I write my why am I buying Square. So buying Square. Because of the growth in online and mobile payments. So hit submit, and then it will send the trade in for execution. Okay, and so in somewhere in the next 5 or 10 minutes, it'll execute the trade. I'll come back to the screen, it'll show me this, and it'll convert to real time. Hopefully pretty easy, straightforward. Questions about any of this? Yes?
Are you able to see the results of other people's teams?
So, good question. So when you look at other people's teams as a non-administrator, what you're gonna see is you'll see the other teams. Sorry, I'm trying to pick a. You'll see the other teams, but you won't see the name. You're just gonna see XXXXXXX. So you'll see your team and a bunch of X's. So you won't know exactly which team is in front of you or behind you, but you'll see the absolute ranking. So you'll see the dollars, you just won't see the names. And you can't click on another team and see their portfolios. I, as the administrator, can. And by the way, I don't count with my simple trades. And by the way, I'm gonna violate the rules because I'm not gonna have 700,000 invested if I just bought Square. But the point is, you won't be able to see their trades. You can see yours, but you won't be able to see theirs. So what I'll do from time to time over the next 6 weeks, I'll log in and I'll show everybody kind of like where you stand and you kind of see a who's who. But nonetheless, you'll know the rankings, but not the names. Good question. Other questions? All right. As I said, the only person that's going to see your portfolio is your team captain. So the rest of the team is going to have a harder time following along, but I'm going to give you an idea of how the rest of the team can follow along. So one of the features you're learning about in your certification is something called worksheets, W for short. So worksheets are a way to track stocks and portfolios. Okay, very easy to use. Now I already have a few of them, and there'll be some sample ones here, but the simple way when you get to W is to create a new worksheet. Okay, and it's got some templates. Right, so you can use one of the templates. Like this is the buy side template. Here's a sell side template. Here's a performance heat map template. Or here's a basic with almost nothing in it template. Pick a template. Or I'm going to start with a buy side template since we're investing in stocks. And then create your template down there. It's going to give you what looks like an Excel file. You type in a ticker symbol, Square, now called Block Inc. And it's going to load in Square. Okay. Now let's say I also buy, click here, I buy Target, and then I buy, I don't know, United Health Group, then I buy, what about earlier, Costco. So very quickly, it'll show me the people that I've bought here, and it'll give these performances. Let's say I don't really care about the, you know, short-term versus five-year performance Z-score. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to delete this column. And let's say I want to add a column. And again, I can add a column on just about anything. So if I add a column, insert a column, like let's say I want to put in, I'll make up a number here, ROIC. There's the ROIC of all the companies, all right? Or if I want to put in a column, shares, you know, shares outstanding for the company or shares owned or something like that. So I can actually track how many shares I have over here, news and events. But nonetheless, I can track it as a kind of a mirror portfolio outside of my Bloomberg portfolio. But here's the other advantage of this. If you create a worksheet and then you go up here to share, put in the Bloomberg account of your team members, and then they'll be able to see that worksheet. So you'll be basically collaborating on this shared worksheet. And then they'll be able to edit, you'll be able to edit, and everybody can kind of see it. So what I recommended to the earlier sections, two potential worksheets. One, the actual stocks you bought. Two, ideas, trade ideas. So if you're trying to come up with what else might we consider buying, put it in a trade idea spreadsheet. When your team meets, you can talk about what you might be buying or selling. Just kind of helps you keep track of that. W, worksheets, how you get there. Questions? You can also use this for any other purpose. All right, let's talk about lecture note two, EIC. So EIC is a framework that stands for E as economy, I as industry, C as company. And I mentioned this already a couple times in this class, but about half the performance of any company is the industry. So this is a way to analyze the external environment that the company's in and the impact that environment will have on companies. So this is actually used by Wall Street. Pretty simple and straightforward framework. Let's start about E. E is the economic, macroeconomic environment. So I'll give you an example. Oil prices last year, particularly after Ukraine was invaded by the Russians, basically spiked to over $100 a share for a good part of the year, right? Well, if you just saw in the last couple days, Exxon just reported $59 billion in one quarter profit. Chevron did like $42, $43 billion. Like the oil industry made record profits. They made the most money they've ever made in the history of the world, right? So great for the industry, but that's the point. Those economic conditions, oil prices in particular, really benefited the oil industry. Airlines, where 20% of the cost of flying a plane is the fuel, were hurt by the increased costs associated with spiking oil prices, right? So two industries that are very much tied to the price of oil. A year ago, the yield on the 10-year treasury was 1.5%. Today, the yield on the treasury, 10 years, about 3.6%. That rise in interest rates has completely upended the mortgage market. Because a year ago, you could get a 30-year mortgage for 3%. Now you're getting the same mortgage for 6.5%. That means that for the same house, you're paying about 50 to 60% more on a monthly payment. That has ground the housing boom to a halt. And people are not buying nearly as many houses. Housing prices are now starting to fall. Well, that's affecting the construction industry. And you're also starting to see a bunch of layoffs as a result of that, because people aren't hiring as many workers, they're not building as many houses, and the consumer's getting more skittish about spending because the equity values of their houses are now starting to go down, right? So what I'm just telling you is these factors in the economy affect things. Car prices are starting to come down because same thing. The interest rates on cars, car loans used to be 4%. Now the average car loan's over 6%. People aren't buying as many cars because the interest rates to buy a car has gone up. And so that has actually started to affect the industry. So what I'm also telling you is these macro indicators affect companies and industries in different ways, and they're not necessarily one size fits all. So some industries will be more impacted by factors than others, but that's what you're going to have to figure out, starting with Intel and semiconductors. And I will give you a hint, okay? So one of the things is semiconductors, particularly to retail computers, are very much tied to the economy. People tend in good economies to buy more electronics. In bad economies, they tend to buy less electronics. What Intel found out last week is in the fourth quarter, as the economy started to slow down, people weren't buying nearly as many computers. In a way, that shouldn't be a surprise. It was to the analysts, but that's the point about the semiconductor industry. You know, 2 years ago, when we were all stuck at home for COVID, we were buying lots of computers. Now, the world has changed. The economic situation is part of the reason why it's changed. That's part of what your next assignment is going to be about. All right, so economic impacts. So we got to figure out what they are. Second part of the economic impacts, because the question that we're trying to answer is basically, how does this macroeconomic environment affect the industry and the company that we're looking at? So semiconductors and by proxy Intel. And then the other question is, how much does it impact? like, do changes in the economy, are they a big deal to a company? Are changes in the economy not so much a big deal to a company? That's what we also have to kind of figure out. So another data point we're going to look at is beta. What is beta? You guys are finance majors. What's beta? Yeah.
It's how a stock has historically moved up or down compared to the market.
Okay. So if a company has a beta of one, what does that mean?
It would move one for one with how the market moves.
So the market goes up, it goes up. The market goes down, it goes down. And that's the point. A beta of one means that the market goes up 1%, company goes up 1%. Market goes down 1%, company goes down 1%. A beta of two means that the market goes up 1%, company goes up 2%. The market goes down 1%, company goes down 2%. It's going up faster, goes down faster. A beta of 0.5 means you're not going up as fast, you're not going down as fast. Okay? So we're going to use beta as a proxy for economic sensitivity. Right? Because the whole idea is, if the market's getting better, because the economic situation's getting better, there's more money sloshing around, well, then everybody should be doing better because we're in a better market. Okay? And if the market's getting worse, because there's less money sloshing around because the economy's getting tougher, well, then the company should be doing a little bit worse. Does that hold out? Okay? Because some industries are going to be more sensitive to just the general economic situation than others. And that's a very big question that Wall Street's trying to figure out today, because what is going to happen to the economy in 2023, and what's going to happen to all these different companies if the economy starts getting worse? Who's going to be more hurt than others? And who might not even be hurt? Who might be benefited? That's what we're trying to figure out with the E section. Make sense? So a few data sources. You guys are doing the economic module in your certification. So let me talk about a couple of screens. Number one, ECFC, economic forecasts. It'll default to the U.S. You can look up any country. But this is historical and forecast economic data for the U.S., starting with GDP. So you can see here in 2022, U.S. GDP was 2.1%. 2023, it's expected to be 0.5%. 2024, 1.2%. So the market is actually expecting really tough economic times in the U.S., not really growing much the next 2 years. In fact, as of today, the market puts a 65% probability of a recession in the U.S. in 2023. Okay, so they're very concerned about what's going to happen with the economy. And so you might say, well, gee, where does this 0.5% forecast come from? Click on the 0.5. So just as Bloomberg surveys sell-side analysts for forecasts about companies, Bloomberg surveys different economic firms about their forecast for the economy. And so they're surveying 78 different banks and other institutions to say, hey, what do your economists think is going to happen in the next 2 to 3 years? Bloomberg then averages it. It's the same way they do the consensus estimates. So the 0.5 is the average of all the guesses. And you see, there's not unanimity in 2023. Like, who's this? Bantleon AG, this German bank, thinks there's going to be a recession in the U.S., 0.4% down. So does Comerica. Whereas, pick somebody else, Deutsche Bank thinks we're going to grow at 1%. Econ Forecaster predicts 2.9%. So again, not unanimity, but Bloomberg is kind of using a wisdom of the crowd by averaging them all out. Okay? Make sense? All right. So back to what's on this screen. You have forecasts for consumer spending. You have forecasts for CPI. So, for example, last year inflation was 8% in the U.S. This year it's expected to be 4% and then 2.5%. So the Federal Reserve has been raising rates, and there's a lot of anxiety about what they're going to do today. But the whole point was to clamp down inflation. The market thinks it's actually going to get clamped down on. Inflation is going to start to get lower. Right? That's the forecast. But, as I said, housing starts. This year, 1.3 million. Last year, 1.6 million. Higher rates, building less houses. Matter of fact, labor market. Unemployment was at 3.6% last year. This year, 4.2. Next year, 4.8. All these interest rates are slowing down the economy. People are starting to get laid off. So on the one hand, we're tamping down inflation. On the other hand, people are losing their jobs. You can't read a paper today without seeing some company laying off some 5,000, 10,000 workers here and there. It's adding up really, really quickly, very, very quickly. So this is starting to change. You can see what's happening to interest rates. These are all forecasts, but nonetheless, a lot of economic data. And you can go to any country in the world. Like, I can switch this to China, for example, and I can see that last year, China only grew 3%. That's terrible for China, right? Anything under 5% in China is essentially recession. When you have over 1 billion people in your population, you have a lot of people entering the labor force every year. And if your economy doesn't grow to support all that labor force entry, that causes challenges. And so that's one of the problems China's been having, is that 3% is a recession in China. Anything below 5 is tough. And the fact that they're just getting back to 5 the next 2 years is a forecast, that means there's still going to be tough times in China the next couple of years. You really want to see a country that's screwed, the UK. All right, the bozos that thought getting out of the EU were a good idea, this is where the UK is truly suffering. Their standard of living is plummeting. Their trade balances are plummeting, right? The cost of doing everything is plummeting. They don't have access to workers or capital. And so basically, the UK is going to be in a recession this year with a 90% probability. They are the worst of the major countries. And their hope is actually the worst on a go-forward basis because they don't have the EU behind them anymore. So I'm just saying, like, you can look at different countries, see different pieces of information here. It's not all good, but it is what it is. ECST, economic statistics. This is basically taking the last screen and letting you dig deeper. Okay, so you can just go more deeper into more data points and also give you the Bloomberg screens that track all these data points. All right, so that's ECST. The other one I want to talk to you about is ECSU, which is the Economic Surprise Index. So after the 2009 recession, Bloomberg started tracking this. And what they do is they have 43 data points of economic indicators. See them on the screen. Which they put into six buckets or six categories. All right. And the six categories are housing, industrial, labor, household income, retail sales, and business surveys. Think like consumer confidence index, right? So those categories are tracked, right? And what Bloomberg does is it does a forecast versus actual. And the surprise is basically variance. So for example, pending home sales reported on January 27th were up 2.5%. That's the actual result. That was a positive 1.84% surprise. It was up 184 basis points higher than expected for what people expected home sales to be, okay? Now, over here is the day that this information was released. This is before the data was released. What was the S&P 500? This is after the data was released. What happened to the S&P 500? So reacting to the positive surprise for home sales, the market started to go up, all right? So I'd say it's the only reason it went up, but that's the point. Key economic information, what happens to the market when the news released, positive or negative surprises, right? Now, when they aggregate these into an index, right? What it does, and this is what they've been tracking through 2009, should be pretty intuitive, is they do two things. One, what happened to the stock market since 2009? Two, what was the surprise index through 2009? And what you see over time is pretty strong correlation. It's not one-to-one, but the idea is when there's positive economic surprises, the market tends to go up. When there's negative economic surprises, the market tends to go down. So if we're starting to think about what's the economy today and what's going to change over time, seeing whether we're getting positive or negative surprises is a clue to directionality. And what's happening right now, based on the latest data that's being released, big negative surprises in housing, big negative surprises in industrial. We're not making as many products as we and spending as much money on production as we thought. Big negative surprises in retail. Consumers have gotten much more stingy about what they're buying. And big negative surprises in consumer confidence and other how do you feel about things, right? Those are all big negative. The two areas where we've had positive surprises, people have been keeping their jobs and people have been getting raises. They're making more income. Now those typically become lagging indicators. As a matter of fact, look at the papers right now. All those job losses in the last week are gonna start showing up in here, okay? So I have a feeling the labor market and everybody's income, those are gonna start turning a little bit more red, okay? But nonetheless, this is why there's a pretty high probability of recession, because the leading indicators are not pointing in a positive direction right now. But nonetheless, you can see what they are in here. Questions about any of this? This is part of your homework assignment. So the important part is semiconductors and Intel. How do they get impacted by this stuff? Okay. Now the next thing you're going to look at, back to our lecture note, is the concept of beta. So here's the correlation. A better economy should be better for industries. A worse economy should be worse for industries. How tied is an industry to the economy? We're going to use beta as the proxy. So that's the point. If you're a high beta industry and a company, then you're probably going up and down faster than the market, which means you're probably more economic sensitive. If you're very low beta, you're not going up and down as fast as the market, which means you're probably less economically sensitive. So we use beta as another data point to help us answer this question. So this is actually one of the screenshots you're going to have to turn in for your assignment. So you go to Bloomberg, and again, I'll use Costco. You're going to do this on Intel, so I'm going to choose Costco because I don't want to give you too much the answer to Intel. But you're going to go to Costco, and then you're going to go to RV to look at your industry. You use the analyst curated one by default. Then you're going to go over here to the tab called Markets, and then you're going to go to the sub-tab called Beta. And so what Bloomberg's going to do in real time is calculate a beta for every one of those companies on that list and do a market average. So there's the industry beta, the raw beta, for discount retail in the U.S., and there's the current beta for Costco. So I want you to tell me what a 0.88 means. So for discount retail, industry beta is 0.88. That's the raw beta. What does that say about their economic sensitivity? Yeah.
They're economically sensitive due to them having closer to a beta.
But relative to the average company? Yeah.
They move less than the market average.
Yeah.
A little less sensitive.
A little less sensitive than the average company.
12% less sensitive.
Yeah, 12% less sensitive. So here's the point. If I think about discount retail, sure, they're sensitive, but they're not as sensitive. So yeah, I kind of care about the market, but not as much for that, as say another company. Does that make sense? And this is the intuitive part. It's part of your write-up. Why? Why is this less sensitive? And if you think about and do research on discount retail, it's kind of like people, and I'll simplify, but people tend to go to discount retail more in bad economic times. We trade down. That's when they kind of shine. And that's the thing. When we go back to good times, we tend to trade up. We spend more money on other more luxury goods. So they tend to be a little bit more plotting, right? They don't boom and bust as much as some of the other retailers. And that's what you see with their slightly lower beta. Now, what about Costco? How is Costco's sensitivity compared to the rest of their peers? What's Costco's beta? 1.09. Any above one means you're a little bit more sensitive. So Costco is much more sensitive than the average retailer, discount retailer. So that's the other insight that we have. Why? Why might they be more sensitive? That'll be part of your write-up, but that's the first part you need to understand. This is E. And this is a screenshot you need to support your E. Now, if you're wondering how does Bloomberg actually estimate the beta, you can actually type in beta. And what Bloomberg does is a regression. So it's going to start with a scatter plot diagram. It defaults to 2 years, 2 years weekly. So on a weekly basis for the last 2 years, it's going to take the change in price of the S&P 500 and the same week change in price of Costco. It's going to put a dot on the chart, right? It's going to have all those dots, so 104 dots over the last 2 years. And then it's going to draw a trend line. The slope of that trend line is your beta. Okay, that's how they actually estimate the beta. Now you'll notice the second row down says adjusted beta. Adjusted beta comes from statisticians. And the idea is it's a smoothing coefficient is put into the raw beta to move it closer to the mean, right? Because statisticians believe in regression to the mean. So they put in a smoothing coefficient to move it closer to the mean. So the adjusted beta is 2/3 of the raw and 1/3 of 1, and then they recalculate to get the adjusted. So it just takes the beta and moves it 1/3 closer to the mean. That's how they do the adjusted. Now, Bloomberg defaults to the adjusted beta, right? We're going to use the raw beta just as a choice in this class. Yes?
Nothing. I just want to ask, which beta?
In this class, I don't want to get into a political or religious argument, so we're just going to choose raw to keep it straightforward. And the raw is just the slope of the line. So how sensitive are you without smoothing right now? But here's the problem. It's 2 years. All right? Now, here's the interesting thing. I can change this if I want, meaning if I want to click on a 5-year beta, it'll recalculate the beta based on 5 years worth of data. Notice when I clicked on 5 years, what happened to Costco's beta? It's 0.743. This is part of the problem with historical data. In the last 2 years, Costco's been booming because in the pandemic, that's where we went. But over a longer period of time, we said discount retail doesn't go up as fast and doesn't go down as fast. And when we look at a longer time horizon, that's more representative probably of what Costco's really doing. So this is the other thing. Even though we're defaulting to the 2-year beta on that generic screen, if you do this, I would expect you in your write-up to say, you know what, in the last 2 years, Costco's actually had a beta that's above 1, but that's probably not realistic to their long-term. Their long-term beta is probably more like the discount retail industry. It's below 1, and that is really more of their realistic economic sensitivity. This is where you're going to use your brains, right? This is where you can't just chug and plug, or plug and chug, right? Because if you do, you might miss out on some things. And so there's nothing wrong with adding another screenshot. Here's the 2-year beta. Here's the 5-year beta. I think the 5-year is more relevant to the economic conditions of Costco. Right? Questions? In fact, if I want to regress against the Morgan Stanley World Index, here's Costco against over 2,000 global companies in all different countries over the last 5 years. Still 0.74. So that's the point. Like, when I start looking at Costco, discount retail, that's a little bit more intuitive. E. Second part of the framework, I. I'm sure you're probably thinking, gee, now I understand why he's asking for 500 words, because we just finished one of the three sections you're going to be writing up. All right. I, industry. We have defined already in this class that an attractive industry has a positive spread, ROIC greater than WACC. That is a value creating attractive industry. An industry that has a negative spread, ROIC less than WACC, is an unattractive value destroying industry. Okay. The real question, why? Why is this positive spread? Why is this negative spread? In 1984, Harvard Business School professor Michael Porter wrote a book called Competitive Advantage. In that book, he outlined a model called the Five Forces Model, which has withstood the test of time, as a framework to explain industry performance. So that is what we are going to use to help us with the I part of the analysis. So the I part of the analysis is going to say, okay, screenshot number 2, RV. So I got my peer list with my industry average, the market cap weighted average. I'm going to go to custom. You're going to do this for Intel. You're going to take the template of ROIC minus WACC that you've saved, that you just did for homework 1, and that top line is going to give you the industry spread. Based on this data, is Costco in an attractive industry? Yes or no, and why? How do you know?
Yes, it is.
Why?
Because the return on invested capital is higher than the weighted average.
Okay, so here's the point. He said it is because the ROIC is higher than the WACC. He's exactly right, and unfortunately, he's going to get a 0 in his 500-word essay. Why? Didn't mention the numbers. So I'm going to give you a chance to say that again.
19.74% is higher than 9.34%.
All right, you're still getting a zero in your paper.
I have to repeat that.
Why am I giving a zero when he said 19.74 gets 9.34? Why is he getting a zero for that answer? Because that's not the industry. The industry is the market cap weighted average. It's 8.08 against 13.21. So I'm saying, I know it's a lot, but you got to pay attention to what we're trying to do here. So the first part is industry. It's not the company. Now, when we get to the third section, which is competitive advantage, C, company, then you would be correct about the 19.74 against 9.34. But the industry, it's the market cap weighted average. Everybody with me on that? So you have the screenshot. The first line of that paragraph, this is an attractive industry because the ROIC of 13.21 is higher than 8.08. That's about a 5-point spread, and that makes this an attractive industry. The rest of the next two couple paragraphs, using the five forces model, why? Why is this spread what it is? Explain in the concept of the five forces. So again, you've done this in previous classes, but let's do a quick refresh. What are the five forces? First one, power of the buyers. Who has the power in the relationship? Do you have power over your customers? Do your customers have power over you? Right? If your customers have power over you, it's going to be hard to make money. Right? So what are the things that will determine buyer power? Right? One is, are you dealing with an oligopoly where there's only a couple players and the customers don't have a lot of choices? Or you're dealing with cutthroat competition where there's lots and lots of choices that they have access to and everybody's very competitive because no one can really dominate that market. That's going to have a different impact on buyer power and how availability are those options. So I'll give you an example. You are Stanley Black & Decker, the tool company. Okay, you sell DeWalt tools, Black & Decker tools. You go to Bloomberg. You type in SWK, which is Stanley Black & Decker. Then you type in SPLC, which is the supply chain. Yes. Come on, Bloomberg. There we go. SPLC, which is supply chain. You hit enter. What Bloomberg will show you graphically, on the right are Stanley Black & Decker's customers. On the left, Stanley Black & Decker's suppliers. So let's look at buyer power, which is the companies on the right. Stanley Black & Decker's biggest customer is Home Depot. Home Depot represents 15% of Stanley Black & Decker's revenue. The second biggest customer for Stanley Black & Decker is Lowe's. Lowe's represents 15% of Stanley Black & Decker's revenue. The third biggest customer is Amazon, which represents 7% of Stanley Black & Decker's revenue. And the fourth biggest customer is Walmart, which is about 6%. And then the fifth biggest customer is Target, which is about 5%. So let's add this up. The two biggest customers represent 1/3 of our sales, 30% right there. Okay. Then seven, round off 12 and 5 is 17. The top five represent about 47% of our sales. Okay? So who's more important in this relationship? Home Depot to Stanley Black & Decker or Stanley Black & Decker to Home Depot? Who do you think has the power in this relationship? Who's got the power in this relationship? How would you define buyer power? Buyers have a lot of power. Buyers don't have much power. Given this data. Okay. So if I represent 15% of your sales, and the other side of it is the cost of goods sold. You represent 2% of Home Depot's costs. If this relationship ends, who suffers more pain? Yeah.
Home
Exactly. So that's the problem, is that for Stanley Black & Decker, Home Depot, Lowe's, to some degree these other three companies, they can kind of dictate terms to Stanley Black & Decker. Because if you want to meet the mass market at scale, you got to go through them. And that's the point. They know this, and they leverage it. So it's not that Stanley Black & Decker doesn't make any money, but it kind of puts a cap on how much money they can make. Right? So it kind of gives power to the buyers. Same thing with supplier power. Okay? So let's say you're an airline. Who has the power in that relationship? The airlines or their suppliers?
Suppliers.
All right, so give me an airline.
Delta.
Who are their big suppliers?
Boeing
and Airbus. Because they're basically a duopoly. And you want to buy planes, you're going to probably go to one of these two companies. As a matter of fact, Airbus represents 62% of Delta's purchases of planes. Okay? So that's the point. Boeing and Airbus don't compete historically on price because they don't have to. They're a duopoly. They compete on a lot of other features, but generally not price. And the airlines have not made money historically because the suppliers have had a lot of power. Now, interestingly, that changed in the pandemic when none of the airlines bought any planes, and then Boeing and Airbus were trying to figure out who they're going to sell it to, and nobody wanted any planes. So that power dynamic shifted for a couple years. But outside the pandemic, it's been tough for the airlines. Now, over time, that might start to change if other countries, China being one of them, I think Brazil and Canada are others trying to get into the global aviation market and challenge Boeing and Airbus duopoly. But right now, they're the only games in town, and that has been tough for supplier power on the industry. Third force, substitutes. Are there any and how viable are they? Is online education a substitute for colleges and universities? Do you actually need to come to class to learn? I will tell you, 3 years ago, we used to laugh at the online schools, right? No one takes them seriously. They're barely accredited. And my personal feeling was, until the people that graduated from the online schools became the people hiring the online schools, they were going to be at a severe disadvantage. It was going to take a long time before we took an online degree seriously. Well, in 2020, that all changed, right? Because whether you liked it or not, you were taking classes online. And we realized that that was a valid way of teaching. You may not like it, but we got to figure it out. And so I'm telling you, substitutes quickly became much more viable to education. Same thing with business travel. We used to laugh at Zoom and WebEx and Teams. No serious business traveler would use those. We go to places. We fly to places, particularly business class. Airlines love that. Then we learned that we can actually do online meetings without traveling anywhere. Now the airlines are much more worried about substitutes than they used to be because that's what's the trouble of getting the business traveler back, right? So that's another thing that we got to start thinking about. What are the substitutes? How viable are they? Fourth, barriers to entry and exit. If it's really hard to get in this industry because of regulation, technologies, patents, whatever, that allows the industry to make more money. If you look at the pharmaceutical industry, their spreads are really high. You know why? What's the biggest barrier to entry in the pharmaceutical industry?
Capital.
Patents. They get patents on their drugs, and they're the only game in town. And so you basically can't sell a substitute. Read the New York Times article about AbbVie and a drug called Humira and how much money they made because of that patent and the fact that they were able to block all the other competition, even when the patent expired, by coming up with creative ways to extend that patent. So because of patent and regulation, the pharmaceutical industries create their own mini monopolies and they make a lot of money until those patents expire. And then the game completely changes. Right? But nonetheless, what are the barriers to entry? Fifth, rivalry. Rivalry in the short term is supply and demand. When there's a lot of supply and not much demand, there's a lot of rivalry because everybody's trying to fight to sell something. It's harder to make money. When there's a lot of demand and not much supply, it's easier to sell something, even in semiconductors. Think about the pandemic. When everybody's trying to buy electronics all at once, huge demand, limited amount of supply for chips, prices spiked. They all made a killing. That dynamic is shifting right now. That's what we saw with the Intel report. What does that mean to the rivalry in the industry? Not all of these forces have equal weight for every company in every industry. But you have to talk about all five forces for Intel. Yes, ma'am. Do I want you to do what? So I want to talk about that in 1 second, but I'll answer your question two ways. So for your write-up, you have to explain the five forces today, and you have to explain the spread today that you see in that graph that you're turning in, that in the Bloomberg screenshot, the RV spread screenshot. You got to explain that. The other thing you have to do is you have to tell me what's going to happen to the spread in 5 years. This is the future industry. The way you're going to do that is you're going to give me a future five forces. What's going to happen to the five forces in 5 years? Because here's the point. If the forces don't really change in 5 years, then the spread's going to probably be about the same. If the forces become more favorable in 5 years, then the forces are going to improve. And that's going to actually allow the industry to improve. If the forces become more unfavorable in 5 years, then the industry performance is probably going to get worse. Spreads are going to decline. So when you do your write-up, what's going on with these economic sensitivities? What's going on with the beta? How does that affect the company that we're analyzing? What's the spread today using real numbers? And more importantly, how do the five forces explain the spread today? Will those five forces change over the next 5 years? If so, what does that mean to the industry spread? That's two-thirds of your write-up, right? Now, a word on, and I'll come back to this in more detail in a minute, but these are real companies, and you need to use real information about real companies, and I'm guessing that most of you don't know too much about semiconductors. Matter of fact, some of you might even know who Intel was. So here's the point. You're going to need to use real-world data to answer the questions. It's expected. Which means you're going to use real data sources to answer the questions. And I fully expect that you might even take some of the stuff in those reports and put it in your papers. But you work in an you're a student at an academic institution. You can't plagiarize. So two things. You have to have a bibliography, and you have to footnote if you copy and paste. Right? Because that's the point. Like, every paper that you submit is going to go through Turnitin. And Turnitin doesn't just work on external data sources. It works on assignments turned in for the current assignment. So it's like, ha, 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 I'm going to turn in a paper. He's not going to catch me because I'm going to copy what was on somebody else's student who turned in, and Turnitin's not going to see that. Yes, it will. And so when I get in the TAC a high percentage that your paper is matching everybody else's from a data source in this class or outside, we're going to go look at your paper. And if we see footnotes in bibliography, we're not going to send you the honor council. If we don't see footnotes in bibliography, you're going to the honor council, and you're going to get an XF, because you're going to have no defense about why you plagiarized something. And I'm telling you, plagiarism is one of the worst offenses you can commit at this university. So don't do it. But you are going to have to use external information. Otherwise, you're not going to be able to answer these questions. So what I'm telling you, bibliographies and or footnotes. Don't copy and paste without one of those two. Particularly if you copy and paste, you need a footnote. You can't have word for word of somebody else's work in your papers without giving credit. Because the whole point of plagiarism is you can't represent somebody else's work as your own. And the university takes that very seriously, and I do too. Right? And we will have no sympathy if you do that. Okay? So whatever your, my dog got hit by a car and I was so sad, I decided to just copy and paste somebody else's paper. Great, you're still going to get an XF and academically fail. So there is no excuse. Don't do it. But that being said, when you do it, source. As long as you source, you're okay. Yes, sir. Absolutely. Yes. How do you cite it? So what I'll say is this, is that my view of sourcing is a little bit more loose, meaning I don't care that you do it in exactly one formal way, like you don't have to use Bartlett's footnote format, but what I do care is that you do have some kind of source. You know, so if I copied from BICO, then I should have even a parentheses, source Bloomberg BICO for this, end parentheses. Like, just say that if you use somebody else's work, that you use somebody else's work. Give them credit for it. And there's nothing wrong with that, because that's the whole point. Your job is to curate and synthesize and analyze and interpret, not to create original research. Right? You won't have time to do that, and I don't expect you to do that. And analysts don't do that. But don't just use somebody else's work without saying that you use somebody else's work. And if you quote, copy and paste, then basically make sure that you do put quotes around that. Don't copy and paste without quotations. Even with a bibliography, that's still considered plagiarism. Yes?
So if you mentioned a spread in your write-up, can we just like parenthetically cite? Like,
yeah, from this Bloomberg screenshot. Right. And you'll have it in the paper, and it'll be clear that it came from the screenshot. That's not the plagiarism that I'm really worried about. Right, I'm more worried about, like, you read a newspaper article or a J.P. Morgan analyst report, and then that suddenly looks like your work. It'd be like me coming up here and saying, Joe Perfetti has created this framework called Five Forces to analyze the industry. This is my unique academic content. Like, that is horrible. I'd be immediately fired by the university for doing something like that. All right, you can't do that. All right, you got to give credit. That's why I started this conversation. Michael Porter, 1984, Five Forces Framework. I'm going to give references. You got to give credit to others. Right? But that's what's going to be important in anything you do, not only in the semester, but in your career. Even when you get a real job, you don't want to plagiarize. It does not help you. All right. Third section, C, competitive advantage. We talked about this briefly on Monday. These are the charts from the book. So this chart is ROIC performance over time of companies broken into quintiles. And the important thing about this is it shows that over time, ROIC regresses to the mean. So the top performers up in the here don't stay top performers forever. The next chart is revenue growth. Growth of publicly traded companies into quintiles. The fastest growing companies don't stay top growing forever. Their growth rate's slow. So that's just what we know. So what does that mean by Darwin's at work in the marketplace? There's going to be regression in the mean. The question is, if you're one of those top companies, how long are you going to be one of those top companies? And what's allowing you to be one of those top companies? That's the C section. That's the competitive advantage. So we're defining competitive advantage, very specifically, as spread relative to industry. So to have competitive advantage, you've got to demonstrate a higher spread than your industry. That's competitive advantage. Okay? So back to your screenshot. The second screenshot you take, and I'll go back to Costco. RV, custom, Bloomberg terms being slow. RV custom, it'll show the spread. And so in the I section, here we go. In the I section, you're going to use market cap weighted average for your spread. In the C section, you're going to use the individual company spread compared to the market cap weighted average spread. So given that, does Costco demonstrate competitive advantage in this industry? Yes, no, and how do you know? Does Costco demonstrate competitive advantage? Yep.
Yes, because the industry spreads like 5% and Costco has like 10%
ROIC. Yep. And we'll give you partial credit for that, because I'd like to hear the actual numbers. So I'd like you to say 13.21 minus 8, which is 5%, and 19.74 minus 9, which is 10%, and 10 is greater than 5. But he had the exact right idea, okay? Because that's the point. So Costco's clearly demonstrating outperformance. Everybody see that? All right, why? This is part of your write-up. Why is Costco outperforming? What is giving them competitive advantage? So tell me. You guys probably shop at Costco. What makes them good? Yeah.
I would say they probably get their stuff cheaper than a wholesale company. And then people are buying
where they go. Yeah, so they're true cost leaders. So they're the low cost, that's getting a lot of volume. And they do sell in bulk, so people buy bulk in volume. What else gives Costco a competitive advantage? Yeah.
The membership.
That's the big one. You were paying $60 a year for the privilege to have those low prices. That's all pure profit. So take number of members times 60. That's straight to the bottom line. It's one reason why Walmart and Target can't be as profitable as Costco, because they don't charge membership fees. And that membership is extraordinarily profitable for Costco. Don't underestimate how that hasn't given them an advantage historically. All right, we go a few more on what they can do. The fact that you're going to a warehouse, all right, to buy the products, which is pretty cheap, and essentially you don't get any bags or anything like that, so they do everything they can to keep their costs down. But their workers are actually will actually help you. Like, you walk into Home Depot, you ask a worker for help, good luck, right? But talk to Costco people, they're usually pretty friendly. And on a personal level, I love their $1.50 hot dog deal. I think it's the best deal in town. $1.50 for a dog and a drink, hasn't changed in years. I love that. But anyways, this is my own personal opinion. But back to Costco, they have competitive advantage. Why today? And here's the point, what's gonna happen in 5 years? In 5 years, are they gonna maintain this advantage, or are they gonna be like everybody else and see Darwin at work? I don't know what the answer is, but that's what you're gonna tell me, and you're gonna explain why. Yes?
Is the why more so like an opinion, or is it all based on
opinion? Well, considering we're talking about 5 years from now, it's partially based on opinion. I can't tell you that if you tell me what's gonna happen in 5 years that you're wrong, but it should be based on some sort of data-driven, at least somewhat fact-based opinion following this process. Right? I'm not saying, like, let's flip a coin to figure out if Costco is going to do better in 5 years or not. It came up tails, so no, it's not. Like, that wouldn't be a good answer, right? But, so here's the point. This is about the answers. So I want to go to the other half of the conversation. Where can you get information to help you do not only this assignment, but other assignments, okay? So a few things. One, BICO stands for BICO, Bloomberg Intelligence on a Company. This is gold. So, as I said, we're not the only ones trying to do this. So what Bloomberg does is they hire former sell-side analysts that used to work on Wall Street, that now work for Bloomberg, and they curate the company information and the industry information in summary form that is given to investors in bite-sized chunks. So here's all of the key things that are going on for Costco. And here are, if I click here, here is the industry report on Costco's industry, retail sales, retail staples, okay? So again, use this. This will help you. They're doing what we're doing. Second thing you can use, BRC. BRC are the analyst reports that we have access to. Read a JP Morgan report. Read a Deutsche Bank report. Take a recent one, because they are doing the same thing we are, particularly doing Intel and semiconductors, because they're trying to figure out the exact same information we're trying to figure out. And so they're summarizing it in their research reports to investors. So BRC, read and use some of these. BI, Bloomberg Intelligence, higher level than BICO. This is the industry dashboards. Every industry has its own dashboard. So for example, if I search for retail, you would search for semiconductors. This is the retail staples dashboard and wholesale clubs. This is the industry dashboard. Again, the industry primers here. Industry peer list is here. Macroeconomic environment that impacts the industry is here. Industry analysis is here. Company analysis is here. EIC. That's on the BI screen. Okay? And other information, market shares, etc. A lot of data here. The final source I will highlight to you is outside of Bloomberg. On Elms, there's a link to something called VBIC, our online library. When you go to VBIC for the university, there's a tab down here for industry data sources. The industry data source that's relevant is something called IBISWorld. IBISWorld is a company that writes Five Forces summaries for a living. So this is an industry research report. And what they do is they do it in all sorts of industries. So you type in your company or industry. So in this case, I'll type in Costco. And it'll say, okay, here's the warehouse clubs and supercenters report. Click on that. There's their industry report. Okay. And when you go through this, industry performance, Five Forces, industry outlook, 5 years. So again, a lot of what you need is out there. I don't expect you, particularly as undergrads, to do all independent research. I do expect you to give me some opinions as you kind of sort through and curate this. But that's what I said, you're going to probably need to figure this stuff out by getting some research, and that's perfectly acceptable. That's part of why you're using Bloomberg. Just don't plagiarize. Questions, comments about any of this? So again, this is an individual assignment for Monday. First one is on Intel and semiconductors, right? The week after that, you'll have another one in another industry, and then you're going to have, in a few weeks, a team project. So what I'll do in the team project, which would be group project number two, you'll basically, as a team, have seven to eight people, doing an analysis on a company and industry, and then you'll do a 10-minute PowerPoint presentation for 10 minutes of your grade. I will tell you that when you do the team analysis and you get eight people working on it, I'm gonna expect a little bit more research than one person over a couple of days. But that's what's coming as you learn how to do this. Saw a hand over there? Somebody had a question? No more questions? All right, again, if you haven't figured out who your team captain is for Bloomberg, please do that, submit through the Google Doc, start trading today, get out of cash by Monday, and we'll debrief Intel on the assignment on Monday. Final thing, TAs start office hours this week. So remember, Thursday, Friday, the TAs have office hours. So if you want to go talk to them, they're out there to help you, including with this assignment. All right, have a good week. See everybody on Monday.